Good afternoon, ladies and gentlemen. Let's get started. First of all, a very warm welcome to everyone. I understand we have a number of special guests in the audience, including those who may not have had an opportunity to attend RFF events. So a very warm welcome to you. Thank you. Come again. I welcome you on behalf of RFF's President Phil Sharp. I'm Molly McCauley, RFF's Vice President for Research. President Sharp sends his best regards to you, Minister Blanchet. Thank you so much for being with us today, and thank you to all of those with your embassy who have helped make this work. We're just honored and delighted to have you here. Because I do appreciate we have some very new visitors and guests, I wanted to say a word or two about resources for the future. This organization was established at the request of a U.S. presidential commission to objectively and comprehensively assess the relationship between natural resources and society. That year was 1952. At that time, economic analysis of natural resources and our environment was really just beginning. This year, RFF has celebrated its 60th anniversary. With respect to economic analysis of natural and environmental resources, and our work remains grounded in topics ranging from forests, water, air, and land to energy, environmental regulation, climate, ecological wealth in the United States, and also with colleagues and collaborators in China, India, Europe, Latin America, Africa, and Canada. In our anniversary celebration this year, we've hosted three Nobel laureates in economics. Joseph Stiglitz, Kenneth Arrow, and Thomas Schelling. They've spoken about income inequality, geoengineering, and in the case of Ken Arrow, a reminder that as humans we have unique rational capacity to manage our resources under this informal epoch that many have designated the Anthropocene. We've also convened discussions on the future of fuels, cognition, and how we relate to our environment, and most recently, limits to ingenuity in alleviating resource scarcity. So continuing our anniversary year in this tradition of inquiry and leadership, we're truly honored to host Minister Blanchet. Thank you again to the embassy. I'm going now to introduce the Master of Ceremonies for our discussion, RFF Senior Fellow Dallas Bertra. Dr. Bertra leads much of RFF's work in the electricity sector. He's also selected often to provide technical assistance in the design of trading programs in California and in the Northeast Regional Greenhouse Gas Initiative with respect to carbon management. Dallas, with others, has also recently authored a paper, Linking by Degrees, Incremental Alignment of Cap and Trade Markets. And this really sets the stage very well for our discussion today. I'm hoping Dallas will say a word or two about this paper and its direct relevance to our topic. Dallas will also introduce the minister more formally. Dallas will remain Master of Ceremonies in managing the Q&A and then appropriately dismiss us at the appointed stopping hour. So, Dallas, come on up.
Thank you. Thank you very much. Thank you, everyone, for being here. My thoughts for you is just to launch the event here is that, you know, at one time, many advocates had a vision of a designed carbon market that would be comprehensive, ambitious, and efficient. And despite many brave efforts, it has become clear that perhaps a carbon market could not be given birth full form and had to evolve and emerge through a series of actions taken by jurisdictions at the national and subnational level. So today, a more common view is that the global carbon market might be built from the bottom up, and evidence of that is found in Quebec. One of the exciting things we're going to hear about today is Quebec's pending collaboration with California in a linked cap and trade program. 2 weeks ago, we were in San Francisco. We brought a dozen Swedish academics and regulators to San Francisco for a meeting with about 100 counterparts in California in a workshop that was titled, What is the Value of Being First? Perspectives from the California and Swedish Experiences. And one thing that emerged from that is that while they view themselves as leaders do not want to be all by themselves. They want company and collaborators, and that's what we have and welcome from coming from the province of Quebec. Quebec is not only home to a wonderful environmental treasure, but also to wonderful environmental leadership. And so we are honored to welcome Yves-François Blanchet, the Minister of Sustainable Development, Environment, Wildlife, and Parks for Quebec. Now you have a biography on your chair, so I refer you to that, but his background is compelling. It includes academic credentials in history and anthropology, and while he was a student, he was involved in politics with Parti Québécois. Then he left that work to move on to success in the entertainment industry, where he started a couple companies and also was a teacher before returning in 2008 and recommitting himself to politics. And in addition to elected office, he has been president of two consecutive Earth Day celebrations in Quebec. And with that, it is enough by way of an introduction. I want to invite the minister up now for remarks. Thank you.
Ladies and gentlemen, I would like to thank Peter Nielsen, Director of Communications, and Molly Kay McCauley, Vice President for Research and at Resources for the Future, for the invitation to present to you some of Quebec's initiatives to combat climate change. But first, I must say that I have done some reading about RFF, and what an impressive think tank you are. I haven't read as much as I would like, but I promise myself to read some more. I often say that the decisions have to be made and based on knowledge, science, and research. And you are the best possible inspiration in order to do just that. I also must say that I am already grateful for your patience with my far from being perfect English and accent. And I will also tell you that my speech won't be very long because I would like to have more time to exchange and take questions. One of the virtues of taking questions is that when I answer one's question, I'm sure there's one person fully interested in what I say. And you will also allow me a few words in French. Peut-être que par le biais de la web diffusion, il y a des gens du Québec qui écoutent cette intervention. Et je vous prie de croire que c'est un honneur d'être ici pour pouvoir m'adresser au RFF. Et possiblement même que par le biais de Twitter, quelques questions, sûrement pas les plus faciles, pourraient se rendre du Québec jusqu'à nous. Quebec decided to tackle the issue of climate change. We believe in leadership and, really, in a bottom-up approach, starting in our own backyard. We did collaborate with the Canadian government and attended international conferences, but our actions did not stop there. Within our present jurisdiction, we also got busy at home. We are now considering an even bolder climate change target from the official target, which is presently at 20% by the 2020 target in time. We are considering to reduce the total GHG emissions in Quebec by 25% below the 1990 levels within the next decade. And with strong commitment, the right tools, and perseverance, we will succeed. Over the last 15 years, Quebec has made the fight against climate change one of its government priorities. And I have made it mine. Let me give you the context in which it occurred. Quebec has experienced its share of climate-related events, such as a severe ice storm in 1998, which froze part of Quebec economy for a long time, and recent flooding along the Richelieu River Valley. There are also more permanent effects, such as erosion along the iconic St. Lawrence River, and melting permafrost, which threaten the way of life of Aboriginal communities in northern Quebec, and therefore cultural diversity. In this context, reducing GHG emissions is central to our action, and bolstering our resiliency is a necessity of our society, and I shall say our societies. Early on, the government of Quebec's first strategic move was to work at better understanding the science behind climate change. In 2001, the government invited scientists working on climate-related issues to join a research consortium initiated by the Quebec government. It was the birth of the Uranus Consortium, an important think tank devoted to climate change science. Within a few years, the scientific cluster was able to give us a clearer picture of what was coming our way. Given little to no emission reductions gains to be made in our power sector, which is virtually all hydro, actually 97% of our energy is hydroelectricity, and very different situation than most of our neighbors, we focused on industries, buildings, and transport sector, where reductions are notoriously difficult to achieve. In Quebec, 43% of our emissions are coming from the transportation sector. But in order to take action, we needed money. To address that need, in 2007, I must say, to be clear, that in Quebec, in the Quebec Parliament, our National Assembly, both major parties do share about the same view about the issues we are discussing now. So when I use we, I do it in a very open way. We did something that no one had yet dared to do in North America. I must pause here to give warning to some sensitive ears in Washington, D.C. We, Quebec, actually imposed a carbon tax. The government imposed this tax on fossil fuels, and we reinvested the money to help businesses to become more energy efficient and to switch to less polluting sources of energy. The government of Quebec also invested in public transit, cycling paths, electric vehicles, and more efficient freight transport. In 2009, Quebec's per capita GHG emissions stood at 10.4 tons, compared with more than double that figure in the other Canadian provinces. Then there, it is an average of 23.5 metric ton per capita. This excellent outcome was due by and large to our source of power for homes and businesses, hydroelectricity, and is also attributable to the implementation of concrete initiatives to reduce GHG emissions. The most recent data available confirms that concerted efforts by individual, communities, businesses, and the government in the fight against climate change are bearing fruits. Accordingly, Quebec's GHG emissions in 2009 were 2.5% already lower than in 1990. However, this trend will have to improve under the current government. Moving forward, Quebec has recently focused its effort on developing a carbon market. A cap and trade system has been in place since January 1, 2012. The first compliance period under the system began on January 1, 2013, covering some 80 industrial and electricity production plants. Starting in 2015, some 50 distributors of fossil fuels will also fall within the purview of the system. At that point, nearly 85% of GHG emissions in Quebec will be covered by cap and trade. Last April, Quebec held its first test auction. Close to 100 stakeholders in the various industries took part in the auction, which went off without a hitch. Last May 1st, Quebec also began to distribute free emission units to few industrial emitters, marking the start of transaction on the Quebec market. The first formal auction is set to take place in the fall of 2013. Quebec relations allow us to link our cap and trade system with systems in other provinces and states, notably California. The California Air Resources Board also authorized the adoption of a regulation last month, thus allowing its system to be linked to our own. Quebec and California authorities are working within the Western Climate Initiative, known as the WCI, to ensure that market infrastructure and procedures are fully functional in 7 months from now. We are confident that Canadian provinces in the United States and states in the U.S. will follow suit in the coming years and join the WCI regional carbon market, making it an even more efficient and high-performance system. I must precise, actually, that it was the political main target that was set between Mr. Mathieu Rodriguez and me when we met about the cap and trade system. It is absolutely necessary for us to convince some new players to come around the table. And since this is bottom-up initiative, we believe that it will come from one, another one, and another one. And then the masse critique, I'm sure you understand without me translating, will be achieved. And therefore, this model will be implemented in a larger and larger and larger scale. Again, Quebec will reinvest money collected from its cap and trade auction into a series of initiatives that aim at reducing our GHG emissions by 25% below 1990 levels in less than a decade. We need to do more, and electrification of transport is our next frontier. Now, let me say a few words about this. The Quebec government believes that the future lies in the electrification of private and public transportation. In Quebec, the transportation sector represents more than 43% of our GHG emission. So there are serious reductions to be made here. Quebec has many assets in this field. And I must also add that there is some good business to be done here. We have a robust, smart electric grid, which already has the capacity to handle at least 1 million electric vehicles. Electric buses are also in our line of sight, and we will be testing new models within the next year that should be perfectly adapted to our cold climate and hilly geography. Our aim is to fully ride the wave of electric vehicles and be part of the economic development that will be generated by it. By 2020, we project that 25% of the sales of new light passenger vehicles will be for electric or hybrid plug-in electric vehicles in Quebec. And the government is helping with generous rebates. I was at TELSA here in Washington yesterday. Let me tell you, it is exciting and it is promising. By 2030, we plan to have 95% of all public transit within Quebec operating also on electricity. I am glad, actually I am privileged to be here today to share with you our optimism and tell you that public policies can work. Politicians can be convinced. Work at the local level makes a difference. In Quebec, we do believe in bottom-up strategies to influence the future, and we are perfectly suited to be a significant player in that field. We hope that we can inspire other governments to join us in the path toward the green, low-carbon economy. And therefore, I thank you very much. Thank you.
I'm going to ask you to, you had a paper on your chairs, but I think, are you going to collect them and hand them to me and have me read them, Peter?
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah.
Right, okay. But I'd like to take the moderator's prerogative to ask a couple questions, which I think everyone will be interested in, and at least one person for sure.
I must say, however, that I am a scientist, but I am an anthropologist. So you might find some limitations.
No. First, I think we'd like some clarification that Quebec had a carbon tax initially and then now is moving towards a carbon market. Is this going to replace the carbon tax or will both be in place simultaneously?
One of the things we want to avoid is having industries to have to live with more than one system. There are two possible problems. One is very easy to fix. There will be no occasion two system being implemented at once in Quebec. So as soon as this new way to do things is implemented, and it was implemented, there's no more carbon tax being raised in Quebec. And the other issue is not to have another level of government implementing its own system, which therefore would compete with our own. We do not fear very much that because the reality of GHG emissions of Canada being what it is, if they are to set a standard, it will be much lower than Quebec's. So we can more easily say that Canada should not interfere and it should let our system, which will then be linked with California, proceed by its own volition.
I see. That's interesting. One other question for you. Many of us are aware that British Columbia put a tax in place on carbon in 2008. That tax has increased now to a level of $30 Canadian, and it covers transportation fuels and natural gas and coal. What was the thinking in Quebec in choosing to move towards a market as opposed to staying with a carbon tax?
First, our carbon tax was much, much lower than British Columbia's. But mainly, the idea is to have a more, I don't know how to translate, souple, a more flexible mechanism that would allow industries to choose between buying credits or reducing their emissions by adopting, implementing newer and better technology. Since this system is the translation of a very well-known economic mechanism, which is the pure market, we suppose and we are very confident that industries will be much more comfortable and therefore that they will play along much more easily.
Mm-hmm. A key component of that is the reinvestment of the auction funds in program-related investments that are going to try to, it sounds like, introduce innovation and new infrastructure to achieve further carbon mitigation goals. Some of that was being accomplished under the pre-existing carbon tax in mm-hmm. Quebec. Does that play a key role in getting industry support for the introduction of a carbon market in Quebec?
Actually, it does. The whole amount of money which was raised through tax and that will be raised through this new system will be reinvested in helping industries and other groups in the society to reduce our emissions. So the fact that we did raise a tax might be surprising or raise questions with some of the elected people in the United States.
But it does come with the full reinvestment. It does come with a strong effort by the government in order to take part in this necessary reduction of our emissions. And there were some questions raised, but there was no opposition. And it is the closest things I have seen to a complete consensus in Quebec about the necessity to go forward with that kind of initiatives. If some little details have to be fixed, it is clear that the whole idea is very well received.
That's really interesting. Finally, for my part, Quebec made some modifications to your own carbon market design in order to facilitate and enable linking to California. There's a little bit of give and take, perhaps, on the side of both jurisdictions. I don't know if you were personally involved with that. To what degree do you see that as being necessary, that the programs are very similar before they can link? And also, what was the political economy of that, making adjustments in the Quebec program so that it might more easily dovetail, we say, or merge with California?
There would be more than one answer to that. Okay. First, it always is very complicated to harmonize different regulations. But since California and Quebec were the first ones to undertake such an initiative, we were more, let's say, open-minded about it. And it was not that hard to achieve. We even had to do some slight changes recently in order to be more perfectly linked. However, since the up-to-bottom approach did not work, we will have to proceed the other way. It will be bottom-up. Working bottom-up means that there will be two players, and then there will be a third one, and then we will be five. No, there are up to 60 possible players around the table. And when we achieve this masse critique, I think everybody will come along. But in that process, we will have over and again to adjust and adapt our regulations. And we all will have to be very open-minded about it because each time, because there is not one set of regulations that can be implemented in every places. We will have to be open-minded in order to convince some important states or provinces to be part of this cap and trade system. So regulation changes will have to become somewhat part of our way of life.
We have some questions from the audience, and I'm going to interpret a couple of these. I recognize the inquiry as being technical in nature because it's coming from a couple RFF colleagues, but I think I can interpret it in a way that puts it in a broader policy context than which may be easier for you, a more fair question for you. But one of them gets at, coming to this as an economist, a deep-seated question that economists are always bringing to this policy question, which is why does there need to be, in your own words, please, why does there need to be investments in program-related infrastructure and innovation when the carbon price by itself, some would argue, should be sufficient to provide incentives in this regard? And related to this is the suggestion by one question that auction revenues might instead go to reducing other taxes, and perhaps that would be popular with industry as well. Have you had a chance to think about these program design issues?
Any income from the cap and trade system will have to be invested precisely and dedicatedly into that topic, into that issue, which is very, very, very important. So we do not think that creating some other kinds of incentives with that money would be wise. It could even affect the very nature, the very intent of what we are doing. And also, we, and I do not believe that by itself, a simple cap and trade system will achieve our goals. Mm-hmm. We need to do more. Of course, this cap and trade system will cover 85% of our emissions in Quebec. But we still have to see if this level of reductions will bring us to the target. Also, this money does provide us with an extraordinary opportunity. Reducing GHG emissions is not only an issue for the largest industries. Mm-hmm. It is an issue for transportation. It is an issue for a large number of smaller ideas. And it does provide us with some money to support local projects, local initiatives, and make the whole issue of reducing our emissions a more democratic one.
I'm going to pursue this question one times further. I'm very sympathetic with what you're saying, but rarely do we have a chance to have a government official who has the perspective on this that you have here before us. And so I want to ask the question yet again and to try to be more penetrating for you.
I'll do my best.
We say, do you know what I mean when I say a straw man? I set up an argument that is that for you to argue against.
Mm-hmm.
Well, if you're putting a price on carbon emissions, is from your perspective as a government official, is that perhaps not enough? Can't that price not be set sufficiently at a level that would do the job for us and then take government out of the picture entirely, except for the purpose of setting a price? Is that enough, or is there something else that's needed?
The price of those credits is an issue by itself, and it can be taken from two extremities. If we do set a price high enough to make sure that by itself it does bring us to our target, we might have on the economy an ill effect. And I would even say that we have to keep incentives, and we have to be open-minded about the way we go forward with it, because however well-intended industries might be, they will not welcome this amount of money that they will have to pay.
Mm-hmm.
If we push our luck too far, we will have an ill effect on investment and economy.
Mm-hmm.
I would even say that by itself, this initiative has to be shared by California's neighbors and Quebec's neighbors, because there will be some states and provinces and jurisdictions that will say, you should come to my place instead of going in Quebec or in California, because I do not have such a tax and I do not have such a cap and trade system. So it might be going against the very principles of free trade and open economy. So we believe that in time, everybody will be part of some system that will be the grandchild of this one, but that it will happen. On the other hand, this cannot be implemented without serious consideration for investment and economy. We have seen this morning that in Germany, they've gone back to producing electricity from coal because of the very low price of carbon credits in Europe. When they implemented their system, they emitted too many credits. And in an economy which was not doing so well, the price, the value of those credits went very low. So low that they were not an incentive no more to reduce GHG emissions. And they are now facing quite a challenge in order to rebuild a working deal around the table of European nations in order to tackle again this issue. So what we did was to set a floor price at $10 a ton. And when it started, it went pretty well in California, and the second auction did see the price go as high as $13.70, something like that, which is a good performance. And since it might happen that at the beginning of the process, Quebec might be more of a buying market, it should maintain the price. In order for this system to have a real value and be effective, the price of the credits, the units, has to naturally remain at a certain level.
Mm-hmm. Folks in the audience may remember that the Waxman-Markey proposal also would have had a floor price. But in contrast, the European system does not. That's mm-hmm. an important distinction that you're making here. Mm-hmm. So there's a couple questions that have come in. You mentioned neighbors, and there's a lot of interest about your neighbors. The Regional Greenhouse Gas Initiative in the Northeast U.S. states is a program, a cap-and-trade program, that's more modest than the ambitions in Quebec. There's Ontario that's close by. What is the prospect for engagement with your closer geographic neighbors?
We know of the system of the New England states, and it does make them, primary targets in our operation in order to seduce some new players. And we intend to start doing that very rapidly. And we also have discussions with the state of California in order to do these charming procedures jointly. About Ontario, when I mentioned that I would not want some neighbors to use this initiative of ours in order to attract investments, saying that they do not have this, which is actually an expense for the industries. I don't believe they will do that. And I believe, since they already are seriously interested in the cap and trade system, that we will be able to convince them within a reasonable time frame. However, if I was my own neighbor, I would take a few years to watch. And I must admit that we will have to be very convincing in order to have some new partners rapidly.
Hmm. Thank you, that's great. We have several questions that want to draw you out away from talking about climate policy to broader environmental policies, or at least related environmental policies in Canada. But before we go there, I'm gonna go into a couple more details about the plan with respect to CO2 emissions while we're on that topic. So first of all, one question asks for clarification. Are all of the allowances starting in 2013 to be auctioned, or some also to be given away?
Some are given away in order to have the procedure being implemented more fluidly uh-huh. within the industries, and then the grip becomes tighter, and the implementation for industries related to fossil fuels will be implemented in 2015.
Mm-hmm. So will then there's a phase in of auctioning?
Actually, what we do is to raise the price of the basic price of the auctions and reduce the amount of allowances, because the largest part of the credits are given away freely to the industries. And then we reduce gradually our allowances.
Your
free allocation. Mm-hmm. In order to reach the targets that has been set toward 2020.
So would you say that, I'm trying to understand, in 2015, for example, will half of the allowances be given away for free and half of them sold in auction, or is more or less?
No, there will be more than half of the applications that will be given away freely.
That will be given away freely, I see. But, and then that's that is reduced over time.
That will be reduced over time in order to have all those industries, you know, doing the required efforts in order to really and actually reduce their emissions.
Okay. And what about, well, what in California was described as offset markets, and I know that Quebec has, I believe Quebec has adopted or similar offset protocols for forestry as California, for forest credits.
It's not yet implemented in Quebec. Okay. At first, our offset sectors will be waste, I don't know what to translate, waste.
Municipal waste?
The emission, the emissions coming from the sites where we
put your waste.
Place
yes.
Waste. I'm sorry.
Municipal solid waste.
And that will be one. There will be manure from agricultural industries. And there will be those gases that have an effect on the ozone layer. That will be the main three sectors from which the offset will come.
I see. Really good. Do you have a view about how the program in Quebec and as it perhaps links to other jurisdictions will interact with NAFTA, the North American Free Trade Agreement? Does NAFTA have a role in these emerging markets in North America?
I am certain that in some complicated way, one will influence the other. But I am certain that so far we do not know what will be those effects. There is no formal link between the two. But as I said earlier, it will influence competition between states and jurisdiction in their race in order to attract investment. But I am certain that important industries, and mostly those looking toward the BRICS mainly, will understand that achieving an environmental signature will be a major competitive advantage. And I am very confident that with such a signature, Quebec will position itself in the world market as one place where people and countries may come to find technology, expertise, knowledge, and whatever is required in order for them to achieve their own goals and their urgent necessity to reduce all types of emissions which are now having a serious effect on their cities.
Mm-hmm. Questions are asking, you mentioned that with the introduction, full implementation of cap and trade, that you do not want to see redundant regulations.
Mm-hmm.
I want to ask you first, could you revisit how does that relate, how does the Quebec regulation relate to what might be done at the national level in Canada? We understand here in the U.S. the structure of the Clean Air Act, for example, gives special carve-out protections for California and other states in certain situations.
Mm-hmm.
Is the structure of the law in Canada such that if Quebec can has the option to choose to do its own program, if it's at least as stringent as something that might be developed at the national level?
My understanding of it is that neither Canada or Quebec can prevent the other jurisdiction to have its own regulation or system. Basically, I am a member of a government that strongly believes that at the end of the day, the best solution for Quebec is its own independence. In the meantime, we do have some very cordial, very good agreements with Canada in most of issues that are in jurisdiction that we share. And in that specific case, if Canada had to implement a system, cap and trade, taxation, whatever, that would set a standard for the whole country. They would have to take into account their affection for all oil resources of Alberta, Therefore, we must guess that the Canadian standards would be quite low compared to the standards that we have set in Quebec. If our standards are so high because of hydroelectricity mainly, we are in a position to say to the Canadian government, and doing so in a very friendly fashion, that, I was serious, that since our standards are what they are, they should let us go on with our own system and not have the industries having to conciliate two systems which might be competing with each other and creating a lot of paperwork which nobody needs.
Well, okay, I think that's a good point to transition to a little bit of the broader questions, in which several questions are inviting you to speak on issues about the tar sands, about pipelines, about the environmental inquiries into the Line 9 pipeline. Rather than framing a specific question, maybe if I was a journalist, I would try to make this very difficult for you. But I want to give you a chance to...
Some of mine do.
Yes. take a breath and perhaps give us a perspective. It would be very interesting if we could have a perspective from a Quebec vantage point on the development of petroleum resources in Canada.
I won't be as funny as one might expect. As I said, we strongly believe that in due course, the best choice for Quebec is being an independent country. In the meantime, and I don't know how long that will be, since I do not welcome federal infringements into what we consider our jurisdiction, I would be polite enough not to comment too much on their internal affairs, which means, for instance, that we decided in Quebec, we have an issue about a pipeline crossing the territory. We have decided that the federal environmental evaluation was not at the level we would have wanted it to be. So we decided that we would go on with our own environmental evaluation, and now you will receive a lot of tweets asking what it will be, because it is an issue in Quebec. Everybody wants to know what it will be, and I haven't said it yet. The federal government has respected this desire of ours to go on with our own environmental evaluation and consultation, in which, in our case, environmental groups and activists will be welcome to say whatever they want to say. On the other hand, I will return the courtesy by saying that if I feel entitled to ask Canada to do some more efforts about their GHG emissions, like I would do with Australia or Germany for that instance, I will not comment or express an opinion about their energetic policy. This is their choices, but they do have, as citizens of the world, to be responsible about it and to take into account the fact that the emissions of Alberta have risen by 46%.
Well, let me try to be more pointed with a question. So where did that...
Try.
where did you end up with that with respect to the potential siting of a pipeline through Quebec?
I'm sorry?
A potential siting of a pipeline through over mm-hmm. parts of Quebec.
Mm-hmm.
Well, I was not clear where you really...
Where I stand.
Where you led, where this leads to that, other than it's a process?
It's a process.
Okay.
Like in any process, we... put in place, we implement. As I said, I believe that decisions have to be made and to be based on research and scientific knowledge. Therefore, I would not allow my personal opinion to interfere in the process. And I defer for knowledge and for social acceptability to some consultation process like the one we will put in place for this Enbridge pipeline. And in the meantime, I will try not to let people see what my feelings are.
Okay.
I am less discreet about my position with Canada, but that's something else.
Another issue that is, of course, of interest is, I understand that there is a new moratorium on fracking, a five-year moratorium until what conditions are satisfied?
What we did is to, there was, and I don't know how to put it, some studies have already been ordered, 78 studies from different angles over the issue of fracking in the St. Lawrence Valley. The population of Quebec did not trust the procedure that had been implemented by the previous government. And we have in Quebec an institution which is called Bureau des audiences publiques en environnement, which I will not try to translate here, but we call it BAP. The people of Quebec did put their trust into that institution. So what I basically did was to take those 78 studies and to defer them to the BAP for some public audiences and consultations. The BAP will come back to the minister with recommendations, and the minister will be free to make a decision, but it has to take into consideration those recommendations by the BAP. The moratorium is simply logical. There's not many investments in shale gas in Quebec now because you did a lot of investments and quite efficiently, so we're not competitive on our own market with that. So nobody is drilling. We just said that if the context changes, we don't want companies to start a race toward going on with this sometimes so-called research about the resources. And it's not a five-year moratorium, it's a maximum of 5 years moratorium. We guess that the whole procedure, including the National Assembly making a decision about shale gas, will take something like 18 months, perhaps. When the National Assembly will have made its mind and voted what will be our policy about shale gas and fracking, then, of course, either the moratorium will become permanent or it will be raised. If the National Assembly does not go through this process, we felt that it would be unfair to keep this moratorium imposed on the industries and the companies that have rights, that have claims. So we said that the maximum period of time during which the moratorium will be implemented would be of 5 years. So I'm not sure I was absolutely clear, but
yes, that was very clear. That was good.
Okay.
I understand that.
So this is the reason I do not believe it's a good idea to give a message to those companies that they should go on spending money while we might make the decision as a society not to go on with shale gas, and therefore all that money would be lost.
Well, as we're winding down the hour, I want to give you one more opportunity to provide any closing remarks and invite you. You spoke of the relationship between your government and the rest of Canada, and now I want to invite you to reflect on the relationship of your government and your initiatives and Washington, D.C., the goings-on here. What message would you leave for the Obama administration and Congress, and what would you ask for from them in terms of either signals that help you move forward with what you want to do or where you think the world needs to head?
You know, I have been invited here as a spokesperson at the gala, which is being held tonight, the Earth Day Network gala. And I decided to take this opportunity to meet with people and learn and explain things, mostly learn. And we had the chance to be very well received by high-level officials of the American government. And I am very, very grateful for that. And what I want from the American government and all the states' governments is to consider the possibility of becoming a partner in this initiative, which is being implemented by both California and Quebec. We are, in most issues relating to environment, a good friend to have, a good partner. And this is the only message. And I would say, to answer to the first part of your questions, we sometimes make jokes about it. We sometimes have hard words about it. But the plain truth is that whatever happens, the Canadian provinces will always be privileged and very close partners to Quebec, whatever the choices we make are. So I believe there's no continent in the world where the different cultures are so close one to another. I do not believe that there's anything but changes in the way we manage and administrate our different jurisdiction, but those differences will never create important distances, will never make us apart. So those are friendly and positive and creative relations.
Well, and also I think a very optimistic message looking forward. So I want to thank you for being so open with us and giving us your time and explaining your ideas. And please join me in a warm applause for Mr. Blanchet.
Thank you.